the page here. And I go off somewhere on my own. Our next one is Holy Ground. If you look in the middle of your bulletins, you'll see that we've put together a schedule of Lenten activities for this year. It includes everything through the rest of February and up to Palm Sunday on March 28th. Included in this is the book study. I left my book back there. The Walk by Adam Hamilton, Five Essential Practices of the Christian Life. Several people have spoken to me and are anxious to join us for this book study, and it seems like we're going to do it, seems best to do it in face to face, probably in the conference room back here. I think there are five, maybe six of us so far. So if you feel safe with that form of study, I urge you to pick up a book. There are some in the, on the table in the back. And then join us on February 17th. The verse I want to bring to your attention is Mark chapter 9, verse 2. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up on a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. With us, flowing around and within us. My next tune is Christ Whose Glory Fills the Skies. Thank you. Listen, for God speaks on out to the earth, speaking for all to hear. Thank you.
Today's Old Testament reading comes from 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. Now, when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came up to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they were both standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked me a hard thing, yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elijah kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. Today's gospel lesson comes from the book of Mark, chapter 9, verses 2 through 9. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could reach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who was talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you. created God. May the Lord surround you. And the inspiration of your word. There have been times in my life when I've been looking for a solution or solutions to problems that overwhelm me. Suddenly, out of the blue, the light bulb comes on, and the resolution seems as bright and as fundamental as the sun. When I was in the ninth grade, I took geometry. And in New York State, of course, I also took proficiency exam. Unfortunately, when I took the exam, I didn't understand geometry very well, so I failed. My great aunt had dedicated her entire life to teaching mathematics in the Fulton City schools. When I told her what had happened, she said, "Don't worry, we'll spend the entire summer reviewing Regents' exams, so you'll be better prepared next year." The geometry light came on for me when she explained the mystery of a 30-degree, 60-degree, 90-degree right triangle. Almost everything in geometry is based on this simple concept. After she explained it, I could look at the problem, apply those basic principles to it, and come up with a solution. It was a transformative moment in my high school education. We all have these light bulb moments. Those moments when we are in love. And the solution to some issue in our lives becomes clear, or at least clearer. That's where we find Elisha in his journey with his teacher, Elisha. Elisha is a farmer. He's plowing with a yoke of 12 oxen. When Elijah calls him, the Lord has instructed Elijah to anoint Elisha as his replacement in the prophecy business. That story is back in 1 Kings chapter 19. In our Old Testament reading this morning, Elijah has completed all of the tasks that the Lord has set before him, and he has called him home. And will take him up into heaven with glory. At Bethel, Elijah tries to convince Elisha that he wants to complete the final journey alone. Elisha is having none of it. He responds, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." Twice more, the scene repeats itself, once at Jericho, and the third time at the Jordan River. And Elisha's response to Elijah is always the same. He's committed to staying with his master until the very end. Two times in the journey, local prophets also try to warn Elisha that Elijah's end is near. Each time Elisha replies to them, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." He's committed to Elijah wherever the journey may take him. And he's unwilling to be deterred. awesome actions of the local prophets. Those same prophets tag along until they get to the Jordan River, where Elijah floods the waters with his men. Alone on the other side, this student, the old prophet, asks him, "What may I do for you before I am taken up?" From heaven, up to heaven. Elisha responds by asking for a double portion of Elijah's spirit. Elisha knows what's happening. He's aware of what's at stake. And he's asking Elijah for the tools he will need to continue the work of the prophet. He wants to know how the will soon become the prophet his master has trained him to be after the master has been taken away. And the solution is, if you see me as I'm taken from you, it will be granted to you. With this explanation, Elijah is prepared for his aha moment. When the chariots and horses of fire take Elijah up out of the whirlwind of heaven. Elisha cries out as his master is taken up, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." And he tears his clothes in two after Elisha disappears. God has stepped in to Elisha's life and taken away. And Elisha is prepared to move on after this intervention. In our gospel reading, there's also a light bulb moment for Peter, James, and John. These disciples are the core of Jesus' followers. They were among the first disciples called from their fishing boats on the Sea of Galilee. They accompanied Jesus to Simon's mother-in-law's home and witnessed for healing and the healing of others that night. They are among the 12 apostles Jesus sent out from the mountain to continue his ministry and from the villages around Nazareth. They have been faithful followers and go with Jesus to the mountaintop. They don't know why. They may imagine that they were going to pray, but they weren't prepared for the transfiguration that was about to happen. We might expect their light bulbs to come on when Jesus' clothes become dazzling white. Or even when Moses and Elijah descend from heaven and talk to Jesus. Or especially when the voice from heaven proclaims, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." The only response comes from Peter, who wants to build three dwellings there. One for Jesus, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. But the gospel writer tells us that Peter's response is out of fear, because they're terrified and they don't know what else to say. God has interceded in the lives of Peter and James and John, just as he did with Elijah, with a show of power. He didn't speak to Elijah as his master was taken up into heaven, but Elijah leaves his mantle behind as the object which Elisha can hold on to and recognize that the transformation has taken place. In the mountaintop with Jesus, it is the voice from heaven that declares, "This is my Son, the Beloved. Listen to him." That is the transformative power that Peter and his friends miss. Now, this is the second time God has intervened into the world to proclaim who Jesus is. Back in chapter 1, verse 11, at his baptism in the Jordan, as Jesus came up out of the water, the voice from heaven declares, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." So the "you" in this proclamation points directly to Jesus. And Peter and James and John, they have not witnessed it. Now, however, God's proclamation is directed to them. Listen to him. That is the light bulb that should have gone off in their heads. Light was there, but they perhaps didn't understand the message. Peter and James and John are fishermen, people of action. They want to do something tangible. "Let's build something," Peter explains. But God wants them to take a moment and listen to the one he has in mind. Sometimes God's intervention in the world is subtle, and we may not even recognize it. Something like summer moving into fall, or winter turning into spring. These are also God's actions in our world. They are repeated every year, and we've come to expect them and learn to deal with them without fear or anxiety. At other times, God intercedes in our world in a dramatic fashion, like he did in the stories of Elisha, Peter, James, and John. Powerful, dramatic interventions that will get everyone's attention. But our response must be faithful to the message that God brings us. "Listen to him," God says. "This is my Son." As we enter the season of Lent, take time to listen to the words of Jesus as presented in the scriptures. Listen carefully for the voice of God through the Holy Spirit in prayer. Build our tents, that God calls us to. Love our neighbors, as Jesus tells us we must. Jesus is beginning his final journey to Jerusalem, and his final transformation will take place there after his death on the cross. Listen to him. He may be calling you. I know he's calling me. In some fashion, with either a dramatic show of fire and wind, or just a really bright light. Or maybe just a small voice that will turn on that light in our heads. Jesus calls for transformation in our lives in strange and mysterious ways. We don't want to miss the message. Joys and concerns. It brought to my attention that there was a birthday last week in this lesson. So we'd like to wish Chris a happy birthday. Would you join me in singing happy birthday to Chris? It was mentioned earlier that Marge Parsons' 101st birthday is on Thursday, this week. So let's keep Marge in our prayers as well. Are there other joys and concerns that you'd like to bring to the attention of the congregation this evening? Would you be in an attitude of prayer? O God, you delight not in pomp and show, but in the humble and contrite heart. Overturn our love of worldly possessions and fix our hearts more firmly on you. May yet possess everything, those treasures that you have stored up for us in heaven. We ask especially this morning for the comfort, your comfort and presence with those we have included in our prayers. We especially with those people who are on the front lines of our battle against the COVID-19 virus. Those who protect us in our streets, the police and the firefighters. Those who protect our country from other countries in the world, serving our armed forces. We look heavenly to whatever circumstances they face, guide and direct us. As we also we care for those who need. And all the more, your love in this world. The light of God is shining. The word of God is speaking. In this time of silence, we look to Him and listen to you, for the presence of God in our midst. This will be a few moments of silence. Things we ask in the name of your beloved Son, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory of prayer. Amen. We come to that time in our service when we have an opportunity to share with the Lord the blessings that God has given to us. If you haven't had a chance to put your offering in the front of your back, raise your hand, and Chris will stop by on the way forward. Amen. brightness of God's spirit. Through all the spirits.